Welcome to The Lead, everyone. I'm Jake Tapper. We begin with the politics lead today. President Trump's Rose Garden press conference was intended to be a victory lap on the issue of trade, but instead it was pulled into the vortex of his controversial Supreme Court nominee, Brett Kavanaugh, the new FBI investigation, and questions about Kavanaugh's drinking in the past, with the White House, pressured by Congress, now expanding the ability of the FBI to investigate the sexual assault allegations and anything else they might deem relevant. Just moments ago, the Senate Majority Leader Mitch McConnell spoke about this.
If you listen carefully, Mr. President, you can practically hear the sounds of the Democrats moving the goalposts. Let me make a small prediction. Soon enough, the goalposts will be on the move once again.
Now, whether you think the goalposts about Kavanaugh's behavior have unfairly shifted from sexual assault to drinking too much, as Republicans are saying, or if you think there is additional cause for concern over whether Kavanaugh has been honest about his drinking as a young man, this is now topic A in Washington, D.C., with at least one key Republican senator saying that if the FBI probe proves Kavanaugh was not honest about this, it would be the end of his nomination. Now, CNN's Caitlin Collins earlier today asked President Trump if he was concerned about Kavanaugh's honesty before Congress on these issues.
I really believe that he was very strong on the fact that he drank a lot, and so I don't know where there'd be big discrepancy. Okay.
Now, here's the discrepancy. Kavanaugh has acknowledged sometimes drinking too much as a young man, but he has denied ever blacking out or passing out or ever having had a drinking problem. Tellingly, that is not how President Trump today described his pick. He said instead that Kavanaugh had difficulty with drinking as a young man. Now, that discrepancy might seem significant, given that former classmates of Kavanaugh's are saying that he's being misleading about how much he drank back then and his belligerence when he did. Take Lynn Brooks, who says that she knew him and got drunk with him at Yale.
There had to be a number of nights where he does not remember.
Now, some of Kavanaugh's friends from that time side against that and with his version, and perhaps it's true that Kavanaugh drank to excess on occasion, but never passed out, never blacked out, and never had any memory loss. It's likely unprovable. Or, maybe, Kavanaugh feels he cannot acknowledge ever having had memory loss because the moment he does, Democrats will seize upon it and accuse him of having committed horrific crimes during those periods, crimes that he says he never committed. The problem is, to many people, anyone who's really ever had too much to drink, the claim that he's never had any gaps in his memory might be hard to believe. That's certainly the position of Senate Judiciary Committee Democrats such as Amy Klobuchar.
It doesn't quite make sense to me because, first of all, you have these other people from parts of his life who have said that he was belligerent when he was drunk and other things.
Now, tellingly, when I asked White House Counselor Kellyanne Conway whether she believed his claim that he never had any memory loss, this was her answer. Did you have any concerns that that's not true?
Jake, I didn't go to college with him. I've never been out drinking with him. This is what he has said under oath.
This is what he has said under oath. Does that refusal to say she believes his claim reflect any internal skepticism about Kavanaugh's testimony? Is that why President Trump's description of Kavanaugh's drinking difficulties in college is closer to what all those classmates at Yale are now saying about him than it is to how Kavanaugh describes it? For more on all this, let's get right to CNN's Caitlin Collins at the White House. And Caitlin, President Trump said he was surprised at how vocal Kavanaugh was about his difficulty with drinking. I can imagine Kavanaugh was surprised with how President Trump talked about his drinking today.
Yeah, two different versions of what it was that happened when Brett Kavanaugh testified on Capitol Hill. Today, President Trump implying that Brett Kavanaugh admitted to a drinking problem during his younger years, but Brett Kavanaugh actually sought to do the opposite when he appeared in front of Congress, and that was to tamp down the notion that he drank too much and possibly drank so much that he doesn't remember sexually assaulting someone. That is what he denied. But President Trump used that line today to go after those Democratic senators who have raised questions about Brett Kavanaugh's drinking. President Trump saying today that he believes they're just being hypocritical.
President Trump growing frustrated in the Rose Garden today over mounting questions about the FBI investigation into his Supreme Court nominee.
Do you have a question on trade?
You answered several questions.
Okay, don't do that. Excuse me. Don't do that. Do you have a question on trade?
During what was supposed to be a victory lap for the president's new trade agreement with Mexico and Canada, Trump initially refused to take questions on the drama surrounding Brett Kavanaugh.
My question is on Judge
Kavanaugh. Okay, please, yes.
You said
please.
The FBI should interview whoever that they believe is appropriate. Does that include Julie Swetnick, the third accuser? And can you promise to release the full findings
give me
from
your
the
question,
FBI
please.
After they finish their report?
Give her the mic, please.
But Trump finally took questions on Kavanaugh, saying he won't limit the FBI's investigation into the sexual assault allegations against him while making clear it shouldn't take long.
I want them to do a very comprehensive investigation. I want it to be done quickly.
After Democrats complained about the limited scope of the investigation, Trump said he would defer to Senate Republicans on who should be interviewed.
I think the FBI should interview anybody that they want. Within reason.
Amid the FBI investigation, Kavanaugh is now being accused of lying about his drinking habits by a former Yale classmate who says Kavanaugh wasn't honest when he testified in front of Congress. Asked today if he'll pull Kavanaugh's nomination if it's proven he lied, Trump said,
"This is not a man that said that alcohol was that he was perfect with respect to alcohol."
Trump adding he was impressed by Kavanaugh's candor, but not answering the question.
I watched that hearing, and I watched a man saying that he did have difficulty as a young man with drink.
Though Kavanaugh never described difficulty with drinking, and instead attempted to downplay his consumption, characterizing it as normal.
I liked beer. I still like beer. But I did not drink beer to the point of blacking out.
Trump instead turning to his own sobriety.
I can honestly say I never had a beer in my life, okay?
Right.
It's one of my only good traits. Can you imagine if I had? What a mess I'd be.
Now, we are told by sources, Jake, and it's a little loud as President Trump is leaving right now, the White House on Marine One, but we are told by sources that the White House has told the FBI it is not limited in its probe into Brett Kavanaugh and these allegations made against him. And President Trump made clear today he's okay if the FBI wants to talk to Judge Kavanaugh. Jake?
All right, Caitlin Collins at the White House for us. Let's talk about this with our experts. So take a listen to President Trump characterizing Brett Kavanaugh's experience as a young man with alcohol.
I was surprised at how vocal he was about the fact that he likes beer and he's had a little bit of difficulty. I mean, he talked about things that happened when he drank. So I watched that hearing and I watched a man saying that he did have difficulty as a young man with drink.
That's not what I recall from the hearing.
That is explicitly not what he said.
That he had difficulty and that he has had things happen when he had a little too much. That's not how Kavanaugh described it.
That is explicitly not what Kavanaugh said. But you're also, keep in mind, right, what you see is a position of where you said Donald Trump doesn't drink. He really, truly, it's probably the only thing he can tell truthfully without even glimpsing or blanching at all, he hasn't ever had any alcohol.
And because his brother Fred was an alcoholic.
And died tragically, and he decided from that point moving forward he would never have any drugs or any alcohol, and he told his children that religiously throughout the course of his life. And if you have never had any alcohol, the difference between one beer or a couple of beers or blacking out may not be that nuanced. It might just be black and white. And so you can imagine from President Trump, Trump's mixing the message, partly probably based on his own lack of understanding about how alcohol affects the body.
Margaret, are you accusing our president of lacking nuance?
What do you think? I know, Rich, I know that you feel strongly that you agree with Mitch McConnell. The Democrats are moving the goalposts. Well, what do you make of this? Because that is not how Kavanaugh characterized his drinking.
Right. He's carelessly stating it, as he carelessly states many things. But look, if you could prove that Brett Kavanaugh never took a drink, that would be another fact sort of running against what Ford is alleging, but the fact that he drank doesn't prove anything. You can be a drinker, you can drink to excess, as he acknowledged in his testimony, and still not black out and still not sexually assault people.
That's true, but take a listen to, I'll read the quote. One of Kavanaugh's classmates from Yale, we're all discussing him, he's a professor at North Carolina State, Chad Liddington, he said in a statement to CNN, quote, "I can unequivocally say that in denying the possibility that he ever blacked out from drinking and in downplaying the degree and frequency of his drinking, Brett has not told the truth."
And that's the point. It is entirely possible that you could not drink, to the point of blacking out, or that you could drink to the point of blacking out and still not be guilty. But the problem is he's taken a somewhat implausible position by saying that I drank all the time I was at parties, but I never blacked out, despite what all these witnesses are saying. That goes to credibility.
But no witness says he blacked out. I don't even know how you would prove that. And I have little, Jake's earlier said we were experts. I know, experts in what, Jake? And given this topic.
Drinking but is what I
did. I drank a fair amount as an adolescent. I didn't black out in college. Some people don't black out. It's an experience some people don't have.
Was there ever, can you say that you, I don't mean to probe, sure. I'm sorry. I can say, I'll do myself first. Absolutely, I had memory loss. Of course.
Yeah, you have foggy, but like blank hours where you're turned into this zombie who's sexually assaulting someone.
But that's not the question. Did he ever have memory loss?
But the core allegation, though, is sexual assault. And so far, there's no corroboration of a 36-year-old memory that hasn't been properly interrogated, in my view.
Let me ask. Go ahead, John.
Yeah, but there's intentionally a blurring of the terms right now. And it's because Kavanaugh chose a tack in the Fox News interview to present himself as a choir boy and a football player primarily. And that probably doesn't comport with the way he acted in college or high school all the time, or indeed most folks. And I think the problem is there's a sense that maybe frat culture is on trial here. And we've gone a long way. I mean, cultural standards change, but, you know, the fraternity was a member of at Yale, Deke, was the one that George W. Bush was a member of. The difference is W. could say, you know, when I was young and irresponsible, I was young and irresponsible. And he was running for a president on a popular vote, not going for a Supreme Court seat.
But he also said, and I stopped drinking at age 40 after an encounter with Franklin Graham, and we don't hear that.
No, that's true.
But he wasn't. There's no allegation he's an alcoholic.
Yeah.
There's no indication he's an alcoholic. And I would underline the word primarily, a choir boy primarily. He could have been a choir boy primarily, and he actually was a pretty upstanding student to get as far as he did.
Absolutely.
And still drink a lot. I mean, these things are not inconsistent. And he said in his testimony that he drank to excess. He never denied that. He didn't lie.
You see a gap between drinking to excess and not having memory loss? I mean, that's a bit implausible.
Blacking out is the extreme. Take blacking out off the table for a moment.
Memory loss and drinking to excess at night after the suggestion
in blacking out is that he did this and does not know it.
Yes. The plausibility of you know, what one person thinks is implausible and another thinks is plausible simply can't be the basis for how we determine our Supreme Court justices, right? This is why we have to have a basis in fact. This is why we have to have investigations of the truth, and we have to discern what the truth is. Otherwise, if it's just what you believe versus what I believe or what anybody else believes, this is just a power grab, and this is not the rule of law.
Now I want to bring up the fact that Rachel Mitchell, who the Arizona prosecutor, who the Republicans brought into question, she issued a report. Now, obviously, it's not a full FBI investigation. She did what she could in the time she was given. But her conclusion was that a responsible prosecutor would never bring a case based on the evidence presented last week. And she noted, quote, Dr. Ford, Professor Christine Blasey Ford, identified other witnesses to the event, and those witnesses either refuted her allegations or failed to corroborate them. She went on to cite inconsistencies in her statements to the committee, the Washington Post, her therapist. I mean, it doesn't look very strong when it comes to the effort to convict Kavanaugh on this case. This doesn't help her report doesn't,
and if we're using the logic of a criminal justice proceeding to prosecute someone, to incarcerate someone, of course not. It wouldn't be a sufficiently strong case. But when you have someone who passes a lie detector test, and you have someone who has a strong case, when you have Kavanaugh who keeps saying things that seem somewhat implausible, I think it does raise questions about credibility and character and temperament, as we saw in the hearing last week. And those are questions we do have a right to ask in terms of determining our Supreme Court justice. That's different than determining whether or not someone would pass or successfully be prosecuted.
Kellyanne Conway seemed to suggest to me yesterday that she believes something happened to Professor Ford. She just doesn't think Brett Kavanaugh was the person who did it. Obviously, memory is a tricky thing. That's not what Ford says. She says she's 100% certain. Well, what do you think?
Memory is not reliable, especially given decades. There'd be no such thing as the Innocent Project, which gets people out of jail based on DNA, because they're in jail based on dead, 100% certain witness identifications. Mm-hmm. So what matters is not the memory, it's some corroboration, and there is none at the moment. And in fact, the people that the two witnesses she said were at the party say they have no memory of such an event.
That's somewhat of a misrepresentation of how we understand witnesses. Typically, when it comes to intimate partner violence, when it comes to sexual assault from people we know, misidentification of the assailant is almost never the case.
All right, everyone stick around. We got more to talk about.